David, face the camera. You're on camera. We're starting the show.
Okay. Hello, Facebook and the rest of our audience.
Yes, this is Ham Radio Now, the most important amateur radio program on the internet. And this is episode 300, let me get this right, 341. It came in. It did just like it was supposed to do. And this is also EmComm Extra, episode 15, Eclipse.
I made it 15 episodes, Gary.
You've done more than the EmComm Extras. Eclipse 2, Ares Fights Back. Do you know why I called it Ares Fights Back?
No.
Nobody's guessing yet. It's, well, because the last one was the impromptu episode 340, Eclipsing Ares. Oh, yeah. And I thought people would get mad at that, so had to make it Ares Fights Back. So let's see. Can we send this?
I mean, we're going to have a third episode on this. We'll have to have a wrap-up episode on the eclipse.
Yeah.
Ares versus the eclipse.
There'll be an eclipse.
Revenge of the eclipse.
Well, I think there'll be an. I think there'll be an eclipse three because we send out our requests for people to join us on the show pretty late, and I heard from folks in South Carolina, and they would have loved to be on the show, but it was a little bit too last minute. And their section emergency coordinator had a big Ares meeting yesterday morning as they're preparing for this kind of stuff. And then he got on a cruise. So he left the country. So we're going to try to get them in and find out what they're doing. We reached out to hams in a couple other states, mostly in the Midwest, and no response yet at all. So we'll see. I imagine we'll have you can't talk yet. Now I haven't even introduced you yet. So, as usual, show goes out of control before it even gets started. So we'll probably do one more ahead of the eclipse and then, we'll do a wrap up and see what went on. So, let's introduce folks. In the upper left corner is our regular co-host, David Goldenberg, W0DHG. How are things going in California? Is it cooled down yet? Cooled down
yeah,
there?
Yeah, it cooled down a lot. It has been really hot and really humid, and we were really fortunate yesterday morning to wake up to. It's still in the 80s, but the humidity has dropped a ton, and we worked an overnight. We worked an ultra marathon, and we were very blessed to have good weather.
Okay, so we'll hear a little bit about that in a minute. And then we'll hear a lot more about it in another show.
Absolutely.
In the upper right is guest name three. No, that's in the upper right. There'll be no editing on this. Is the Ham Kid, Sam Reynolds, KM4WDK. And I asked you back because at the very last minute, I thought, well, I saw you on Skype and you said you'd be available. So that's part of it. And you're going to go see the eclipse.
Yep.
And you're involved in this EmComm stuff.
Yep.
So glad to have you back. And you have recently released your episode 3, right?
Yes, I did.
Okay, excellent. And now finally, at the bottom of the screen is, I got that one right, is our special guests from the very far western part of the country. Well, David, you're in the western part of the country. Are they west of you or are you west of them?
I believe that they'll be west of me.
Just slightly. We'll find out.
Left-hand corner.
Don and Betsy Reid. Don's W7DMR. There'll be a short story about that call sign. And Betsy's K7BTS, the EC and AEC of Benton County, Oregon, Ares, and Races, and you guys, thanks for coming on the program. Let me get the big title out of your face.
Thanks.
And you were the first folks to respond to our inquiries about who could come to a show talking about this eclipse thing. And we'll get to the eclipse thing in just a minute. But first, this could be important. So, well, but first, even more first, and this definitely is important, Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. If you enjoy the programs and get something out of them, where have I got that title? That that title. It's hamradionow.tv. Go see Arvin. We subsist on your contributions. So you got a couple ways to do it. You can do a Patreon. You can do individual PayPal contribution. And you can fill out an envelope and stuff a $10 bill in it. All those methods work just fine. Now, what I was really getting to was this thing here. Attention hams everywhere. Let me get the other little title out of the way. There's a property up for sale you may be interested in. This is a Department of the Treasury Internal Revenue Service notice, judicial sale. I'm sure there's a story behind that that I don't know anything about. And let's see, on August 30th at 11 a.m., there'll be an open house. You can go check it out. Register to bid. The property is at 1001 Shiloh Springs Road, Dayton, Ohio, the Hera Arena. And it is up for auction. The arena, formerly known as the Hera Arena, six-building complex, ice rink, ballroom, conference hall, sports events. Doesn't say anything about major ham fests, but it should. Minimum bid.
So I'm confused.
Minimum bid, $850,000. So
you guys made it, Don and Betsy, you guys made a face. Did you make it out to Dayton?
No, we've not made it. I was hoping to.
Yeah.
I plan to retire at the end of this year, and I have a lot of things like that I'd like to do.
Well, it'll be a different Dayton. There's still going to be a Dayton. It'll just be in a different place. So I'm sure there's a story behind why it's up for auction, but I don't know what that story is.
I'm confused because I thought they tore it down and they were selling parts of it on the internet or something.
I guess not yet. I think that may have been fake news. Okay. Just want to make sure that everything looks properly recorded and all my green lights are on. So, yep, everything looks good. In our Eclipsing Aries episode, David, we were talking about how we didn't know how much Aries activity there was going to be involved in the eclipse. We were speculating, you know, maybe not much. There's been a lot of talk about propagation studies, QSO parties, special event stations. So lots of stuff is going to be going on, but nobody was talking about Aries. In the initial email that I sent to you about it, you were actually speculating that, you know, maybe this is going to be like a Y2K event. You know, they threw an eclipse and nobody came.
Yeah, I wondered about that.
So everything I'm seeing is it's going to be, you know, more chaotic than that. But, I don't know. Maybe it won't. So Don and Betsy, you guys are preparing a little bit out there, right? You are the leading edge of the eclipse as it comes into North America.
Close to it. There's one county to the west of us that will get it a few moments before we do. We have a mountain, which is the highest point in the coastal range. So that's anticipated to be a popular site.
And what kind of stuff are you preparing to do?
Well, so the county's been planning for a long time, like a year. We offered Aries communications help. Most of the agencies don't feel that they need it. They think their radio systems will be sufficient. And I think they're probably right on that. There's two things that we're preparing to help with. One is the general emergency management has gone out to all their volunteers and asked for help with a phone bank, which is not very exciting. But if we can help offload 911 calls, get the non-critical stuff handled, that will be a helpful thing. And then the other is, we're all in this meeting room looking around saying, well, the cell phones will probably go out. Mm-hmm. All of our volunteer page out and notice is done by cell phone. And people, and this has happened before, people say, well, how are we going to contact our SAR volunteers and our other helpers if the cell phones don't work? And they all get this worried look on their face, and the Aries people all look down at their HTs, which are usually sitting on the table in front of them, and say, not a problem for us. We know how to do it. So we're going to be running nets and communicating both on ham radio and on the SAR radios. We'll set the SAR group has a repeater that we can set up at one of the mountaintop sites, and we'll be running nets Saturday and Sunday, and then we'll be running constantly Monday morning, mostly just to keep the volunteers connected so that if they do need our help with something, they'll be able to reach us.
Okay, let me get everybody back on the screen here. David, you got any questions or how this is all going to work?
Yeah, you know, I've got a lot. So I wonder, the first one I wonder about is, you guys going to be working the QSO, the QSO party on the side, or just doing the support?
Some members may be doing that. I don't know if I'll have time. I think I'll probably be busy trying to keep track of who's doing that next time around and things like that.
And I'll be sitting in the basement where the ECC is, except for a few minutes when the eclipse happens.
You run out to the parking lot.
I'll be manning the radio room downstairs.
Yeah, do you think everybody at the EOC will go out and watch just for a little while when you hit totality?
Oh,
I think so. The phone bank room they have has windows, and I've told the people who are going to be in the basement that we're not doing one-minute response kind of things. If you go out for 5 minutes and look at the darkness and go back in, nobody will mind.
Now, before we rolled for the program, though, you had a warning to people who are going to go places to watch the eclipse, and that may affect what Betsy goes to look at from the parking lot of the EOC. What was that warning?
Well, we had an eclipse like that 30 years ago, and we all went out into the parking lot at the big electronics company where I work, and it looked really great, and then all the parking lot lights all turned on, and that kind of washed it out.
So, yeah, those darn automatic lights.
Yeah, well, they kind of need them, though, because, you know, it's going to get dark.
Yeah, it's great for safety, but if you want to watch the eclipse, go to some place that doesn't have overhead lights.
So what I was getting from what you were saying was initially everyone said, everything's going to be fine. Don't really need ham radio, until you pointed out maybe they do.
Well, the police and the fire and the Forest Service and those people all feel that they can communicate within themselves, and that's fine. So we don't need to put people up at the mountaintop or out in the field. Now, some counties around here are doing more of that sort of thing. I don't know the details, so I don't want to speak for them too much, but there are a few counties where the hams are manning stations out on some of the more rural highways that their local county wants help in communication. Right. But within the search and rescue and the other, I generally say search and rescue, we have a bunch of different volunteer groups. And we're the ones that the emergency management office calls on when they need something. And they don't care. They don't care what our title is at that point. They want help, and they call for everybody. And right. Within that community, we need to figure out how we're going to contact people.
That's where amateur radio will play a role.
Yeah.
So the county that you're in, what's the population regularly?
And while we talk about that, I'm gonna dig up this map here. This is the eclipse path, and then we'll
the population of Corvallis per se is about 55,000. We're the home of Oregon State University, but during the summer we won't have a large student population. But they're expecting an influx of estimated 400,000 people to the Willamette Valley area.
Okay, so for those that are watching on video, I've got the eclipse map. And if we just look here at the western part of the U.S., this is where it will first hit the U.S. and all within the state of Oregon, the northern part of the state of Oregon. And as we zoom into it a little bit, then we can see where you guys are. So let's see, the big cities, Portland to the north, is not in the full eclipse zone, but people are going to come pouring in.
Yeah.
Down Interstate 5. Or they're gonna
even people from Seattle will come pouring in. I think it's only about a 5-hour drive from Seattle. So.
Yeah, that's what I looked at. You know, and I worked up in that area over the years, and I've done the drive from Portland up to Seattle along the way, and then Portland down to Eugene and back and forth. And I can just imagine that 5 corridor has the potential of gridlock and just, you know, tons of people saying, you know, I'm close enough that I could be in the area and, you know, be part of this event.
Yeah. We have a university here and there's one in Eugene. And if they both hold a football game on the same Saturday, I-5 comes to a stop.
Yeah, and this probably sounds like this is maybe a slightly bigger event than that.
Yeah, yes. Just a little. Maybe 10 times the number of people.
Yeah, exactly. And then, so when that happens, when both schools have a football game and you get the gridlock, do you lose services like the cell phone towers, or you get slowdowns and have issues along those lines?
We used to lose cell phone service. The companies have increased their capability so that we don't right now, but I think with 10 times the number of people, we probably will again.
Yeah.
What is your media telling you about what to expect? Do they even have a clue?
Yeah, they're reporting the estimates of, what was it, 100,000 in this county, 400,000 in this little local area, and more than that. They're reporting on stories like people who've had their hotel reservations for a year, and then the hotel was sold and the reservations were canceled, and now they cost a lot more. Enough to get the attorney general involved, things like that.
But they are predicting complete gridlock. Not just I-5, but probably artery streets.
The other big concern they have in the area is for forest fires. We just came through the same record heat that David did. We were up to 106 last weekend, and we have a big fire just to the east of us right now.
Up in the mountains?
Up in the mountains, yeah, Mount Jefferson.
Yeah, this may not be the best map for seeing all that, but...
right about where your cursor is going.
Okay, so where it turns a little greener.
Yeah, actually, just on the edge where it starts to turn brown again.
Okay, over on this side.
In there.
Camp Sherman and Warm Springs.
They're very worried about, there's a lot of Bureau of Land Management lands where you don't need any permits or anything to camp. Mm-hmm. And people just headed out there and setting up camp in wherever they feel like it and having a problem.
Yeah, because the everyone's expecting it to be very crowded in your relatively urban area. So a lot of people are going to, plus you're kind of famous for rain, right?
Yeah.
Sometimes.
Yeah. But actually we have pretty dry, hot, dry summer. So our probability of clouds is pretty low.
So you guys don't have a lot of morning clouds coming in off the ocean and.
No.
Just the last couple of days when the weather system changed.
Well, but that's what everyone's going to worry about. So if they head farther inland, and I think what I didn't know until on my first trip out there is when you cross the Cascades here and go deeper inland, you've got kind of a desert. Now it's more of a desert in the state north of you in Washington State, but it's still pretty desert-like.
Yeah, it is. It's very dry. There's just that gray area a little bit west of where your cursor is, Madras and Bend. That's a very popular spot for summertime star parties. The universities have observatories out there. And there are small towns that have maybe 1,000 people, a total population, that could just be completely overrun with people looking to see.
Yeah, not a lot of highways. And those are the territories that are even more likely to have the cell phone systems be completely overloaded. Yeah. So... you were saying that you don't want to speak for the hams in that area, but they're not on the show, so someone can talk about them a little bit. What are they thinking about doing?
The ones on the far eastern part of the state, there's one county where I think the entire ARES group is 3 people.
Okay, so they're going to need some help.
They were asking for help, and our state ARES leaders have been running phone conference calls and meetings where we're coordinating. So we're coordinating what frequencies everybody's using, and they're asking any of the counties that are outside the path if they can send some people to help out in areas that are in the path. So there are efforts underway. I don't know how much of that will end up happening, but they're certainly working on it.
There are going to be a lot of hams coming to watch this thing. One of them is in the upper right-hand corner of the screen. Sam, you're in Charlotte, North Carolina. Yep. Let me move the map over to that part of the country for a moment. And so looking at Charlotte, you're not in the eclipse zone, but you're not far from it. You're going with your folks, I imagine, long bicycle trip.
Yep. I'm going down to, Columbia.
you and a couple more million other people, I'm afraid. Have you made plans for what it's going to be like in terms of gridlock and timing? It's your folks that are going to be doing the driving and all, but
yeah,
you can give them the heads up. Although I know the Charlotte media has been talking about it a lot, that don't expect to drive in, watch the eclipse, and drive back out.
Yeah, I guess that would be the question, Sam. Are you guys going a couple days early, or are you going to try to make the trip on that particular day?
We're probably going to try and make the trip on that day.
On that day.
Maybe we'll go down to Greenville or talk to my dad about it.
So let's see where Greenville is. Greenville is in the eclipse zone.
Yeah.
South Carolina.
You know, that was one of the things I think when I look at the map like that, I was like, there are so many, you know, little feeder roads in. I mean, if you don't make it to Greenville and you're along the road, you're in the totality, you're going to see the event.
Yeah.
Gridlock or otherwise.
Yeah, except that I-85. Yeah, I-85 from Greenville through Spartanburg up to Charlotte. You know, how much of this is going to be gridlock? And will you be sitting in Blacksburg, 40 miles outside of the eclipse zone in stopped traffic? Yeah, maybe you can get off and, you know, look at all the little arteries that are possible, but, everyone's going to be bailing and trying all those. So, I mean, this is sort of one of those, who knows what's really going to happen type events.
That's kind of why I likened it to, Y2K. We spent 6 months preparing for that, and we had all hands on deck from, actually, we started about 4 a.m. on the 31st. And, you know, we watched, you know, New Year's Eve kind of crash all across the country, you know, Australia and around the world, waiting to see what was going to happen. You know, I work IT stuff and waiting to see what was going to happen. You know, okay, they're okay there. And okay, they're there. Okay there. And oh, Europe's okay. And now the East Coast is okay. And we, you know, we all wondered like where the issues were going to be. And it turned into a not event. This kind of seems like a similar kind of thing where there's a big part of the country. I mean, even in Los Angeles, I think we're going to get like 2/3 of an eclipse. So it'll get dark here. It won't be totality, but, there will be something to see. And I'm not going to try to get any closer, just cause I got to work that day.
Will it be a non-event because everybody was worried about it and prepared for it?
Yeah, maybe. Maybe.
Well, that you can say that about Y2K, because there was a lot of work that went in advance. I don't know if you had to do that yourself, David, in terms of getting into all those computers that just had the two-digit year thing and then made some assumptions about what the century was. So evidently people patched those pretty well.
Yes, I'm a retired COBOL programmer. And
right.
Yes.
Oh, you were valuable back then.
Once upon a time, yes.
Somewhat more valuable now because there's a lot of systems that are still running.
Still running it, yeah.
Were you... Yeah,
because of all that preparation work, I think is one reason that it wasn't a big problem.
Yeah.
You can't downplay the preparation just because it wasn't necessary.
Yeah,
absolutely.
I buckle my seatbelt every time I drive the car.
So I'm wondering if we can say that about the eclipse, because there's some, we can prepare for some things, but we, you know, really don't know what kind of problems we're going to run into. So Sam, are you going to take a handy talkie with you?
Yep, probably.
Have you programmed all of the Columbia repeaters?
No, I need to do that.
Okay. I'm not, I'm not talking just to you. I'm talking to everybody in the audience. If you're going to drive into the eclipse zone, you got some work to do in advance. So, Don and Betsy, what are you guys doing for the, who knows what's going to happen, contingency?
Yeah, well, first of all, we've chosen several simplex frequencies because we know our repeaters are all in the book and they may be busy. But we want to monitor them. Those are the ones people will call on if they do have problems.
Yeah. I guess that's, you know, sort of one of my questions. Hams are going to be pouring into the eclipse zone like everybody else, and they may look through the repeater guides and get local repeaters programmed in, but will they know which one to use if they happen to be in one of those places, rural, out-of-the-way places, and there's an accident, and nobody sees a cop anywhere nearby, you know, no public safety is watching, and, you know, maybe there's an injury. Who knows what happens? Guy has a heart attack, whatever. And they pick up their cell phone. I'm sorry, all circuits are busy. Please try your call in a couple of days. Okay, they got their ham radio, their mobile, or their handy talkie. Where do they go? Who do they talk to?
That's true. We do have one repeater that is fairly widely known as it's a district-wide repeater, the one that's on top of Mary's Peak, which is about 4,000 feet. And they run a nightly net. And anybody who is at all familiar with the area will know to tune into that particular net because the whole district uses that.
Yeah, and the key of what you just said is anyone who's familiar at all with the area. But you will have lots of people coming in who aren't. So you said you're going to start your net early, though.
We're going to start early, and hopefully people will hear us. But I think you've pinpointed one of the big challenges for ARES in the coming years. We and lots of other people have been running around telling everyone, ham radio is the solution. It will save your neck when things go bad. You should get your ham license. So people come, and we teach a class, and they get their ham license. The question is, what are you going to do? They don't know what frequencies to call on. We aren't really prepared to take their calls either. Yeah. Our focus has always been on supporting the agencies. We have a served agency where some official wants to send a message to another served agency. We know how to do that. But we aren't really prepared to take calls from the general public and transfer them to 911. I think we'll do the best we can, of course, in that situation, but if our phones don't work, how are we going to do that? And I think in the future, we need to work out more. And I've already started conversations with our emergency manager on what should our structure be and how can we get an approved system that you will buy into and support where we can try to meet some of those needs.
Yeah, and I think that's where it goes to as an EC in Los Angeles County. That's where I hope the hams that come here for an event don't know and don't program into the repeaters that I'm going to rely on if I need to use them for served agents. And we have all of our simplex frequencies as well. And hopefully if it comes down to it and they need help, they'll be smart enough or experienced enough to, you know, try calling frequencies because that's what they're there for. And, you know, we always monitor them. I've always got one of the radios that I've got in the car, you know, listening to that when I'm out on the road. And maybe that will be a conduit where we can get some information in from the outside. But, you know, that's a good point. One of the things we stress here is interoperability. There are four or five or six, you know, major ham groups in the Los Angeles County area alone. You know, a group that works with law enforcement, a group that works with the fire departments. There's our group that we work with hospital systems. That's the ARES MOU in Los Angeles County. And then there's a number of other kind of response groups. And how do we talk to those other hams and then how do we serve the agencies that we have? Because we're interdependent. You know, the hospitals will need police and fire. The police departments and the fire departments will need to transport people to the hospitals and need support from each other. And how do you make those things work? Because it doesn't always work. And I wonder where you are in the county that you're in, you know, being a smaller area, does the service that you provide kind of bridge across those areas? Is it just working with the EOC and they have all of those groups underneath them? Or are you, you know, targeted to one area?
We're fortunate in being a pretty small county. The 911 dispatch center in Corvallis handles fire, EMS, police. There is a separate ham radio group at the hospital, and that hospital is part of a network of hospitals, so they have their own ham radio network group. But we worry about the same things, and we practice during our simulated tests and other drills trying to connect. We publish the frequency that we expect to be operating on and listening to with the ECC, and make sure to tell those people, this is where you should call us, and if you need somebody in our county, call here and we'll route you to the right resource. The state ARES group collects that information from all the counties and publishes a directory, which we make sure and have a paper copy of in the ECC.
So, Sam, are you coming up with a plan now?
I was just looking around for the repeaters to use. There's nothing on the Greenville or Columbia Amateur Radio Club websites, or the Richland County or the South Carolina ARES pages.
Nothing. Nothing. Telling you that they're doing anything with the eclipse.
There's not even a mention of the eclipse.
Yeah.
And that was one of the interesting things that, you know, when I went and looked at, QST, you know, they kind of have a cover story about the eclipse, but, or, you know, there's some information in there about it, and one of the magazines I got. But then mostly what we heard back from the ARL about the eclipse is, oh, we're doing this QSO party, and, oh, go out to your local, you know, counties and talk to the ECs and DECs about what they're going to do. And, you know, one of the frustrations I have, I love the organization and, you know, continue to serve, but it's very grassroots. Everything we do is about what we do from our area and the local management. And there isn't a lot of from on high. And this seems like one of those opportunities where there would be folks at headquarters that, you know, specialize in, you know, the emergency response that could help provide some feedback, so that across the country, as you know, this event crosses every state, you know, in one way, shape, or form, and maybe not the totality, but some kind of eclipse, and you know, give us some, hey, we should be doing this, hey, we should be doing that, you know, these are the organizations you should be talking to, these are the things that we should be thinking about, and to the hams that don't participate in organizations like ARES, to say, hey, maybe here's a time that you could step up and participate, or even just be prepared to provide help if it's needed in this event.
Yeah, that's the nationwide component, because their hams are going to be coming to the eclipse zone from everywhere. I was looking at the territory that I'm going to be in, doing my due diligence on figuring out repeaters and, you know, where to look. And in general, Jeff AC4ZO and I and his wife are going to be in eastern Wyoming, a little bit east of Casper. We're going to fly into Denver and drive up from that area. And so I pulled out repeater book and went to look at that. And for those of you that are looking on video, you know, we're going to be in this, you know, just west of the Nebraska line, and all very rural. And there's that one repeater that is listed. Well, that says 220, but there's a 2 meter repeater there. It's going to be about 40 miles from where we're going to be, and over a little stand of hills, at least, not quite mountains. So, I don't think I'm going to be in repeater coverage. Might be able to, you know, just barely squeak it out if I'm able to bring a mobile radio with me, but I'm going to be in a rental car. So, you know, air travel, mobile radios and stuff, that's going to be a little dicey. So but we certainly won't be in handheld range of any repeaters. So you have to look. And Sam, I guess my recommendation to you would be to program a bunch of repeaters for the area, and you may make it to Columbia. You may head to Greenville. Just have everything you can programmed in and listen around. And maybe those guys will be doing what Don and Betsy are doing, which is getting started early.
Yep.
I mean, am I Chicken Little about this a little bit too much, saying we have an obligation through our ham radio capabilities of being ready to be the guy that makes the emergency call, and someone else has got the obligation to be the guy or the woman at the EOC or at net control to take that call and make sure we know where to find them?
I think it's actually part of our responsibility as amateur operators when we agreed to be associated with the sheriff's office. We also agreed to provide that kind of service and to make sure I feel an obligation to make sure things run smoothly and to do what I can.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Circumstances that I'm given.
So I guess, you know, what if I'm complaining about something, it is we're not doing a very good job of letting folks know what to look for, where to go, where to be, and how to communicate with whatever is being set up. And as you're saying, it is very local. It is every community is going to do something different. Now, I know where you're going, Sam. South Carolina is planning a lot. I just don't know what it is yet. So. Yeah. Yeah, like I say, Eclipse 3, in a week or so, we might be able to find them, and we might be able to pull some folks out from the Midwest. It's going to be a big deal in Missouri, in Nebraska, across Tennessee. All those states are impacted pretty heavily, and I think they're doing something, but all we hear about are QSO parties, propagation studies, special event stations. So there's,
I think Dave had a really good point about the calling frequency. That is the one national standard that has been set for a frequency to call and contact people.
Yeah. So I guess I'll be monitoring 510.
Use of that. And maybe the amateur radio community could expand on that sometime in the future.
Yeah. But the coverage is, unless you got a good base station someplace that is sort of acting as the traffic cop. And that's going to be hard to do on 5.2 because you're going to run into, we're talking about 146.5.2. I think that's what you're talking about.
Well, you know, there are calling frequencies, you know, there's a 70 centimeter, there's one on 220, there's a 6 meter calling frequency. Yeah. Mostly I go to 2 meters.
And that's what everybody else does. Yeah, I have never run into anybody on 70 centimeters. The only time I've talked to anyone on 223.5 is when I arranged to talk to them.
Yeah.
From being on a 220 repeater and said, let's try the simplex frequency. And the guy that I was doing that with had to program it in because he didn't have it in his radio.
Yeah.
6 meters, the 6 meter calling frequency is 52.525. And the only thing that makes that somewhat popular is that 6 meters gets band openings.
Yeah.
So people will have that.
Propagation.
Yeah. People will have that in the event of a band opening, but for routine local communications and EmComm, I don't think so.
So I guess the question, so Betsy and Don, where you guys are going to be in that EOC, what is the radio situation set up like, from an amateur perspective? And I know you guys said you were going to be, you know, helping out with 911 calls and doing whatever, you know, they want you to do. And that's kind of what we do too. You know, you show up and they need your help doing this or that or whatever, and you do that. But from an amateur perspective, do you guys have that equipment there? Will you be listening and monitoring? And, are they antennas that are on the roof so that you get some propagation?
Yeah. The antennas are up on the penthouse of the roof, even though we're down in the basement. We have, for voice, we have dual bands, 2 meter, 440. We have a public safety switch, the search and rescue people use, have some frequencies. We also have Winlink set up in there, so we have a couple more VHF radios that we use for that I'm thinking we might make use of during this event just for audio anyway. And we have an HF radio, which has a great antenna in a noise that has a humongous amount of
SWR
interference.
Yeah.
But we have radios down low. You know, we're in the middle of town, down on the flat part. The repeaters are definitely a lot better coverage from them.
So you guys are well covered out there.
Sounds like
opposed to where I'm going to be out here, where there's, you know, like nothing. And I really don't know what to expect in terms of crowds. We're going to be, there's a state park here, and we're kind of expecting that's going to be busy. We're not going to be near it, but we'll have to go sort of past it pretty empty territory. One thing that I did, it's not on, this is a repeater book. And I found no other repeaters close by on repeater book. I did find one close by on our finder, and I sent email to the guy because it was listed in a town about 20 miles from where we're going to be, and said, tell me about your repeater. What kind of coverage do you have? And, you know, maybe you can fill me in on some of the local lay of the land. And he responded very quickly and said, my repeater's been off the air for years. Cost too much to run. And just not, you know, not enough interest and not enough use. And I'm kind of off the air myself. So I sent a note to our finder because I'm one of their trusted sources. And I copied his email and said, you can take that off the books. It's not going to affect a lot of people. It's up in the middle of nowhere. But, hey, it affected me. So I wanted to, you know, I was thinking, you know, it wouldn't be in handy talky range. But, you know, maybe a mobile radio if I bring that. I wish I could drive out in my car with, you know, all the HF stuff. I wish I had time to do that, but I don't. Because
if you're out in that empty a place and you had a handy talkie and a repeater, who would you talk to and when would they get to you?
Yeah.
Good point. Well, I mean, this is not one of those, let's all pat ourselves on the back because we do such a great job in ARES shows. This is we ain't carrying the ball yet. And you guys are, as everybody else out there in the country. And why are we reading about QSO parties and special event stations, which is fine, and propagation studies? We need to do that. Why aren't we reading and hearing about several million people crowding into an arc 70 miles wide across the country where there's no facilities, no communications, and, you know, pretty much just ham radio? Why aren't we hearing about that? Hams.
Yep.
Yeah. I mean, that's the thing. Go ahead, Betsy.
Hopefully my dad will let me stick my mag mount to the top of his car so I can get some maybe good signal.
is that an issue?
Maybe.
Well, at least bring along in the trunk in case you get to the point where you need it, you can put it up. And, you know, that's the thing for me. So, you know, my world is, you know, business continuity, disaster recovery in my real job. And, you know, I think about this from that standpoint of this swath and all these people. And, you know, one of the early shows that I did with Gary when we first came on was the Women's March in Washington, D.C., you know, and they surged in the city there and overwhelmed all of the cell services. And as predicted, when you put that many people in a small amount of space, people have heart attacks and strokes. And a number of hams did step up and volunteered and showed up. And that's great. Those are the kind of stories I love. And it's wonderful. This takes the same problem in just a completely different dimension. You know, it's not a small area. I don't know if it's going to be as many people. My assumption is it's going to be a lot more because of the space that it covers and how can, you know, amateur radio help? I don't think we're the solution. We're not the end all be all. And, you know, that's one of the things we tell our operators is never show up and say, I'm here to rescue you. Or we're here to save the day. Cause that's not the first responders and the professionals. That's the last thing they want to hear. We're just there to help and provide a service. And it sounds like, you know, Don and Betsy, that's exactly what you guys are doing. It's the right way to do it as far as I'm concerned. But, looking at all of that area, all the coverage, you know, probably in the cities we're in a little bit better shape because there's going to be more infrastructure, but all of those little roads leading into the cities or even the interstates, if we get to the point where there is gridlock and you have a car accident or someone has a heart attack or something happens, and you know, I guess driving along the road, I drove from, this last week I drove from Taos to Albuquerque. It's about a 3.5 or 4 hour drive and not a lot of cars on the road. And if something happened, you know, you're going to wait a long amount of time for the highway patrol or somebody to call it in when they can get to cell phone coverage. Take that and turn it into gridlock. How does somebody get to you? How does somebody get to help? And now we haven't created what we're going to be in a situation where it's a big part of the country. And I would so hope that, you know, our organization would do a better job of bringing everybody together and, you know, even like a one page PDF bulletin to all of our section managers that would come out, you know, or even the area directors to say, hey, here's some ideas, Aries, about things you need to think about as the eclipse going on, whether you're in the totality or even in the outside areas, to, you know, re-engage with your served agencies to see what they're doing, to see maybe they want you to stand by or not stand by, and then think about how much you're going to be prepared.
So, Don, you're at the EC level. You're not a section emergency coordinator. But what kind of...
I do not want that job.
what kind of word have you gotten from above, statewide and headquarters? Is all your planning local, or is some of it come in from...
The state people, the SEC and the district ECs have been coordinating communication between the ECs. But ARES here tends to be really locally focused. Every county does what they want to do. And based on the local served agencies, we do what our emergency manager wants. Other counties do what they want. And our state people have been trying to coordinate that a little bit and help people get together. But they're not doing like David suggested, of giving out advice. And I'd like to see ARES in general do a lot more sharing of best practices and publish ideas for people. Say, this is what worked really well here, and these are the things you might do in your county.
Yeah. So I was a little disappointed when I contacted Mike Corey at headquarters, and his response was, talk to folks in the field. A better response would have been, talk to me and let's add some folks in the field. But he didn't. Mm-hmm. He didn't want to talk. So, what can we do? Can't force him to come talk to us. I wanted to show a couple of news stories that one of the folks on our Facebook page pointed me out to. This is from Newsweek, and the headline is: authorities are treating the eclipse, the first in 99 years, like it's the end of the world. And, you know, so this is, you know, some of what the media out there is talking about. And the reason we pulled up this one particular story is it does mention ham radio. There's a brief mention coming down to it. Yeah. The Red
that
Cross.
Kind of goes back to better safe than sorry, though.
I'm sorry. Say again, Sam.
It kind of goes back to better safe than sorry.
Yeah, exactly.
In this situation.
So the Red Cross will use ham radio to communicate when cell phone networks inevitably go down. That their staff and volunteers working on emergency response will have access to some top priority emergency cell channels. I heard from somebody who knows the cellular network, and they said that, yes, there are systems in place for the cell phone systems to give priority to calls that come in from people whose phones have been programmed for a level of priority, but they have to reach a base station first. There's nothing in their radios that has any more radio magic than anyone else's radios, in that if hundreds or thousands of people are picking up their phone and trying to make a call, the base station won't see those priority systems all the time. So it's not a perfect system. There was another story from out there in Oregon, a little bit west of you. They're talking about the territory that's east of the Cascades. And this is, will you be able to call 911 during the solar eclipse? Emergency managers are preparing for cell towers to jam, but I don't know what they can do about it. But this this story mentions ham radio a lot. So it comes up several times. Let's see. Sarah White, operations manager for, how do we pronounce that? Is it Deschutes?
Yes.
Deschutes County. And where is that county?
That's just east of us. That's around Bend, Oregon.
Okay. She says that dispatch centers can't do anything to help with the problem. They won't even know until they start getting landline calls that the cell calls aren't getting through. And so again, this mentions ham radio in a bunch in that story. So that's, you know, it's good to get that kind of publicity, but it's pretty hit and miss. So I guess the bottom line is, some areas ARES is taking it seriously. Some areas we don't know. All areas, we're not hearing enough. So that's the deal. Go ahead, Sam.
I was just going to say, no, we're not hearing enough about this.
Yeah. I'm not here. Don and Betsy, do you hear anything other than what's coming out of your local area?
No, we're just hearing a little bit between our ECs in this area.
Yeah. And David, we did the informal program that turned into the original Eclipsing ARES show in our pajamas.
Yeah.
And you know, started that show because we weren't hearing anything. Well, then folks started saying, we're doing something here. You know,
yeah. And I did a little bit more looking and there are some more articles, but again, they're mostly, they're either the puff pieces or there was the one that you had that there's a county and I don't remember exactly what state it was, maybe Idaho, that they've already declared a disaster, in preparation for what they're planning on. And, I think forward thinking, probably, hope that nothing comes out of it. I mean, that's overall, I hope nothing comes out of it on a bigger scale. But one just wonders, you brought up the phone system. So there's, something that actually came up at our ARES meetings. There's a system called GETS, the Government Emergency Telephone Service. Right. And so GETS is what they have today for, the cellular phone services where you get like a number and a PIN and the PIN gives you priority. That will turn into the, the name escapes me. We talked about it a couple of weeks ago. The new system that they're putting first, is it FirstNet that was in the ARL bulletin a couple of weeks ago? That
the name sounds familiar.
Yeah, it's the one that's supposed to, you know, make all of us hams obsolete from an emergency responder perspective, where they're going to put in all these cellular systems that are hardened and will give all the first responders and all the governmental agencies, you know, priority hardened systems that will always work all the time. And, you know, I know what most hams think of that is good luck and we'll still be here and ready and we'll still keep practicing. And when it turns out that you do need us, we'll be happy to come and provide the service that we provide.
Yep. So, Sam, you're ARES volunteer when they let you, probably a little bit young for doing that. You're still 15, right?
Yeah.
But,
13.
Oh, 13. Yeah, even younger. So it's difficult to put you in positions of responsibility, although apparently you're getting them anyway. You've had some recent events, right? In your episode 3, you were talking about some events that you were participating in. You were out in, what was the event?
Which one?
The one you're talking about in episode 3, you were out at a rest stop and you weren't seeing much action.
It was one of the races.
I guess, a race.
That was the CF Cycle for Life event. I was at the last rest stop on the, and it was on the long route and it was just a really cold day. So no one really decided to go the long route.
Okay, so you didn't see very much action. Were you the ham, or were you with another ham?
The ham.
Okay, so you were the guy, 13-year-old, and you were the guy. So what did you do?
I mainly just told them when the when the riders came through our rest stop.
And there weren't any, or there weren't very many.
There were 8, I think, just to make sure everyone knew where everyone was.
And you had a serious complaint, if I recall. Do you remember what that was? Because you were wearing your ARES vest?
Oh, that was, no, I don't really remember that.
I just watched the episode, so I'm very familiar with what the problem was. 13-year-old kid, but because you were wearing the ARES vest, you got no candy.
Yeah.
They were handing out, and there was, and they had probably had plenty because there was.
That was at the Christmas parade.
Okay. Oh, that, okay. At the Christmas parade. So that's another event that you did. What did you do there?
We made sure the spacing between the, floats was correct so that, floats weren't going too fast or too slow. And sometimes floats would have to do performance and get judged. So we would have to stop all the floats while that was happening.
So you're getting instructions over the radio about who goes next and when to start them?
Yep.
And where? What was your specific job? What was your location?
I was TAC 13, which was just one of the men. I think there are like 26 spots. So I was pretty much in the middle, and I just, like I said, I just made sure all the floats had the proper spacing.
Did you have any trouble getting people to pay attention to you?
No. Wouldn't you go out in the road with a neon vest? that you're pretty noticeable.
Okay, but no candy for you.
No,
because you were working. You were official.
Yeah.
Didn't play the 13-year-old card? I'm only 13.
No.
All right.
Nope.
Doesn't seem fair to me. Okay. Well, I'm not sure what else we got to do here. David, any other questions or comments or whatever coming up?
We've covered a lot of stuff, and I wonder if Don or Betsy, if anything came up for you and the stuff that we just talked about, things you think about, and maybe we're missing some bits and pieces that you have planned or not, or maybe there's a call to action that, you know, so I'm an EC here, you're an EC there. What else do we do to raise a little bit of a ruckus, you know, not too much, around, you know, getting people to say, hey, maybe that's a good idea. Maybe we need to have a little more dialogue, and hey, there are 15 days left until this whole thing, you know, occurs. I don't want to say hits the fan, because I think it's just going to be an occurrence. But I wonder, do you guys have any other thoughts?
Go ahead.
Yeah. One of the other thoughts that you reminded me of is that when we started negotiating for this, you asked us if we had a PIO. Well, not only do we not have a local PIO, we do not have a state PIO, the state areas group. And I would think that would be very useful in an occasion like the eclipse to get publicity for ARES, if nothing else.
That seems to be a common occurrence. We're in the same situation here in Los Angeles, at least in my section.
Yeah, the response we got from the state ARES people was, oh, talk to the search agencies and have their PIOs do all the publicity. And, you know, they're correct for the agency's jobs. That's their job to do the publicity. But ham radio needs someone to promote ham radio.
Exactly.
That maybe that isn't the PIO. It's more of a PR job. But we need people to promote ham radio. And I'm glad you guys are doing a piece of that. It's been good to be a part of it. It's encouraging to me to know that there are other people who have some of the same ideas and thoughts.
Yeah. I have been a PIO. And one of the things that I can tell you about that is that addressing the general media about ham radio is only half the job. Half the job is helping your section manager, your DECs, your EECs, spread the word among hams. Because in theory, as a PIO, we have the knowledge and tools to do that kind of widespread communication. Because there's, you know, for so long here in North Carolina, I was told our method of communicating with the ham community is the nightly net on 3923 kilohertz. Well, that's not good enough.
Yeah.
So spread it out. There's, you know, it's one of those embarrassment of riches that we have and have always had. Too many avenues of communications so that we have to artificially funnel them down if we're going to use them effectively. And we're not very good at doing that. So everybody heads to their favorite repeater frequency mode. And for communicators, we don't very well.
I think that's a whole episode, the whole PIO thing.
I think it's a continuing thread of the EmComm extra.
I often wonder with this gig that I'm having a lot of fun with and really enjoying that I'm not going to lose my EC appointment or my net manager appointment and end up having that PIO badge on. And I guess there could be worse things. But I think that, you know, that's really the fact that we send, you know, people that have questions to the PIO for the hospital that we work with or the fire department or the police department. They definitely have their job and it's definitely valuable and they definitely have a story to tell. But those stories almost never include the what we're doing and the how we're doing it. And, you know, we drill into our teams. You don't talk to media. You don't talk to media. Send them to the PIO. And if we don't have our PIO, send them to the other PIO. And you lose that story. So what you hear in our area in Los Angeles is somebody always gets one little 30-second news blip around field day. When it happens and otherwise you don't hear a whole lot of it.
I don't hear anybody disagreeing with you.
Yeah.
So I guess that's the case. And the league is losing their media and public relations guy, Sean Kutzko, who's done a really good job in promoting a lot of things. I'm not sure how much on top of the PIO situation he's been, because I just haven't heard. It's not something that he has talked hard about. He's spent a lot of time with the special events, the centennial 2 years ago, the NPOTA parks on the air last year, and they got more coming up.
I honestly think that's two separate roles, completely two separate roles. That role for the ARRL and the public media is one, and I think that ARES is a whole separate division, and there should be someone focusing on a national level being a PIO for that organization, because it's such a different mission.
Good point. All right, you guys, I think we are done. And David will have some video from your, what event did you just finish?
Oh, so we just worked the AC 100. It's an ultra marathon. That's where we had about 180 or 200 runners start, and they run 100 miles as an individual, as a solo runner. About 20-25 hours. And they're running, this one is through the Angeles Crest Mountains. I think it's something like 20,000 foot gain and drop over the 100 miles up and down the hills. And I've worked this race for a number of years. Sam, keep working those public service events. I brought my one of my hams from the family. My daughter Gwen is just about to turn 14, and she ran net control and ran the logging software for probably 4 or 6 hour shift along the way, and loves doing the public service and does a great job.
She's getting into this.
Oh yeah. Well, this is her second AC 100. And then she's done Baker to Vegas for 3 or 4 years.
And you got that coming up again in September, right?
No, Baker to Vegas is March timeframe.
Oh, that's right. Other side of the year.
Other side of the year.
All right. You got another event coming up, Sam?
I may be doing the Tour de Cure here in Charlotte on the 17th or 16th. It depends on what day that is. But I'm definitely doing the Cycle for Life event on the 21st of October.
Okay. And you got new radio, it looked like.
Yes.
What'd you get?
The Titera MD380.
All right. So you're getting in on the DMR stuff.
Yep.
Have you got it all programmed and everything? Have you figured it out?
No, I need to, I need to get help with that. Cause I don't think I can get the programming software on my computer since I have a Mac.
That could be a problem. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's why
VirtualBox.
Part of the reason why I'm Windows. Yeah. You might need to get like, what do they call it? Parallels or something that,
yeah. VirtualBox is free. I do a lot of that. Send me a note, Sam. I can help you out.
Okay.
All right. And Don, I wanted to, speaking of the MD380s and the DMR stuff, I wanted to note that your call sign is W7DMR, and it's got nothing to do with that new hotness digital radio thing. It's your initials.
Just blame my parents.
and you came up with that call sign before, well, how long ago? How long have you been a ham?
Well, I got my first novice license in 1968, but then I went off to school and didn't do anything else with it until about 9 years ago.
So you had a big gap.
I had a big gap.
Was it always in the back of your mind?
You know, I think I forgot mostly about it. Going to school, getting a job, having a family, those things tend to be distracting. I got back into it, actually, because we are bicycle riders, and at one of our bike rides, while we were hanging around the registration area with nothing to do after most of the riders left because we were helping to host it, I noticed this person over in the corner with a ham radio and said, "Who's that? What are you doing?"
Could have been Sam.
Yeah, well, it was
up here in Oregon. He was a she.
Yeah. It was the EC of our local ARES group who had been recruited to help out with communication in an area where there was no cell phone service. And so I learned all about it, and they said, yeah, and plus we're running a lot of class and a test session in a couple of weeks. I got back into it.
So that roped you in. Betsy, how did you get roped in?
I never regretted it. I never dreamed I'd find this particular activity so rewarding, but I really like the public service work. I don't mind talking either.
A little bit.
Betsy will be off here in September to help with Cycle Oregon, which is another big event that uses a lot of ham radio operators.
All simplex.
Oh, tell me a little bit about that.
Well, basically, it's a 7-day bicycle ride. Usually, it's a loop, and this year it starts in Eastern Oregon, goes through over the Central Cascades, and comes back over towards the Bend area. And how they have it organized, because they don't want to use the local repeaters. They've had problems. They do a lot of, they do a high point check ahead of time to figure out what are going to be the best places to have these net control vans. And so they have these vans that go out, free vans, early in the morning and station themselves along the route. And we have 8 different vans that follow the riders through the route. And they're usually associated with a given number of riders so that the whole ride is covered. This is usually close to 2,000 riders that we're trying to cover. And so I'm one of the ham radio operators in a SAG van.
So
we talk to these net control operators.
That's a pretty significant event, 2,000 riders.
And a number of days, that's great.
What's really nice is because we're out on the road with the riders and we have such long days is they put the drivers and the hams up in motels along the way. A lot of the other staff have to stay on site in their campground.
Yeah.
What kind of a ham participation can you get for doing something for a full week? I mean, do people take vacation that week just so that they can help out?
Yeah, people do. There are people who've been doing it. Well, several people have 25-year pins for having helped that long.
This will be my 10th year of doing this.
That sounds awesome. And anybody making a little video documentary of the ham radio activity? Oh, I forgot. You don't have a PIO.
Well, and that's not an ARES group, of course.
That's not ARES.
I, I have about three times in my spare time. Well, I used to do it. I'm not doing it right now. But about three times I've sat there and written up a sketch for an article for QST or something and come home and been exhausted and put it down and never done.
Yeah. It's a full-time job for somebody, not a part-time job for somebody who is already doing a serious job. And another one of our continuing themes, David, about these activities is because you guys were saying, well, it's not an ARES activity. It's an event. It's absolutely connected training and experience for emergencies. And I'll bet you have your share of actual emergencies during the course of the event.
We actually have four ambulances that travel with us. Mm-hmm. And so we're not only monitoring the ham frequencies, there's the commercial frequencies too. And we help get the ambulances dispatched because we have to tell the net control operators where the incident happened.
Do they make an incident command kind of situation out of this, or is it more ad hoc?
Kind of.
The overall organization has an incident command structure, but while we're out on the road, it's pretty much it's who is in the field, and then we communicate up to the net, and they take it over from there.
It's like the operations branch when we're out on the road.
Mm-hmm.
We inform the commanders after the fact, but if something happens, the people on scene call net, and they dispatch the resources, and it gets taken care of first, and then we notify them.
So you were saying, well, it's not an ARES operation, and maybe your ARES leadership don't run the communications half of it. I'll bet a lot of the hams are also ARES volunteers.
Yep.
They are.
A lot are from all over the state. It's a distributed thing. So even that organization, if they had the energy to put into publicizing the ham effort, it would help them to get more ham volunteers next year.
Yeah. So do your ARES folks say it's not ARES, or
no? It's just that an ARES PIO wouldn't directly be responsible for this event.
But they could.
We did this event this weekend, and it's not really official ARES, but we really try to get especially the new members out so that they can come and learn and I've been doing this a number of years, and so, you know, I'm one of those. I don't get to operate a lot of radio or the packet stuff. I'm, you know, there for technical to make sure it's set up and it works, but it's really there to get the new guys the opportunity to run and to run the net, run the equipment, to see what it's like to interact with the people. And I work with the best group of guys, and we have a ton of fun, and sometimes there's serious stuff. But I wonder too about that. Like, should it be an ARES kind of event? I'll turn it in probably as public service hours because that's what it is. But was it official through, our organization? Not so much.
Yeah. So I wonder, should ARES be the lead organization for events like this in more areas than where it is?
I think if you look at the ARES mission, that's in the ARES mission. Is to do public service, whether it's an emergency or whether it's an event. You pull up the ARL website and look at the ARES mission. I think that's clearly in there.
Yeah. So another thing that could happen if people said that's the way we want it to be, and just kind of not enough forward thinking or energy or whatever it takes to make something like that happen. Or there are people that say, nope, it shouldn't be part of it. And I don't understand why. All right. Thank you, guys. Let's introduce everybody or outroduce everybody. So down in the bottom corner, we got Don, W7DMR, Betsy, K7BTS. Your last name is Reid. I didn't have room on the title to put your last name.
You're not used to having two people at one location.
it's a tough squeeze. EC and AEC for Benton County, Oregon. And I am pronouncing that right. Oregon.
Oregon.
Am I saying it like a native or like somebody from outside who's trying hard?
Yeah, a little of each.
right. And it also says Racy's there. How much Racy's is in your...
Well, in Oregon, we operate what they call dual registration. ARES and Racy's are essentially the same organization. So we're all registered through our emergency managers and with the state. So if there were to be a Racy's activation, which I don't think has ever happened, but if there were to be an official thing, we'd just be all approved and we'd still keep doing the same job.
Yeah. It's same here in North Carolina, except that we never said Racy's. That never became part of the banner. And these days they've added this OXCOM overlay to it. Are you guys doing anything that's labeled OXCOM besides maybe training?
Go ahead.
Oh, not really. They did offer on the state level the OXCOM class, and I took that a couple of years ago. But they're just starting to get into it and recognize it as a different approach to use the state ARES group.
Okay.
The OXCOM label really describes what we do better than any of the other labels. But we work on ham radio. We work on law enforcement frequencies. We work on other commercial land mobile frequencies. Help with the communication that our served agencies need. And whatever that is, it doesn't have to be amateur.
Okay. So that's what people have been saying for a while now, is that the hams through the FEMA training, OXCOM training, are learning to branch out from ham radio and be communications volunteers, period. So up here in the corner is our ham kid. Where can people find more about what you're doing? You're on the YouTube, and you're pretty frozen, but that's a good frozen picture. I'm not sure why you're frozen, though.
First, can you hear me all right now?
Yeah, your picture's... Is a still picture, but I can hear you fine.
My Skype quit for some reason.
At least the video part quit.
Yeah.
Okay. So you do a show.
Yep. That's on YouTube at the HamKid KM4WDK. It's also accessible at hamkid.com. That's where you can find my YouTube channel.
That is true. I remember that hamkid.com thing. Let me try that here. First of all, I'll make that title go away again. Try to make the title go away. Let's see. Hamkid.com. And there you are on YouTube. HamKid, yep. KM4WDK. And so you got episode 1, 2, and 3, and what's planned for number 4?
Trying to contact the International Space Station. I have that video filmed, but I need to edit it and post it still.
Okay, so it's pretty much ready. It's in progress. You've done half the work, and you got all the editing stuff left to do.
Yep.
Which is my least favorite part of all this television production. Okay, and my co-host up there in the other corner of the screen, for those of you on audio, imagine a screen in front of you. And I'll get your title. This title thing is, I'm slowly getting the hang of it, but.
I think it worked out well.
Ever so slowly. Yeah. That's going to help on it. It is helping in the post production process because I have very little left to do. So move it over to my editor and slap a title on the end, and then we're all done. So what else is going on there, David?
Oh, not a lot. You know, I want to thank Don and Betsy and Sam for joining us. I think it was another good episode, and I'm looking forward to the big day, and I'll be a short, easy walk out of the building, probably with a whole bunch of other people that I work with, to go out and I'm going to put a hole in a card and look at the ground to see what it actually does, as opposed to looking up. I'm not buying any glasses. And I hope you guys all have a quiet and boring day and get to enjoy the totality. And I hope all four of you make it there. Well, I guess Don and Betsy, it's kind of a done deal for you guys.
We could walk down to where we're going to be doing the radio work.
And you may have to.
Well, we're coming to visit and staying in our house and just sitting on our deck to watch it.
Cool. And then, you know, Sam, hope you guys make it in. And Gary, hopefully you have good weather where you are. And
got my fingers crossed.
Yeah, and I'm running on 2 hours of sleep, so there's not much for us for me to say.
You had a busy weekend. All right. Yeah. So Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. Can I get that title up? Do I remember where? I think, have I frozen everything? Oh, there it is.
You're
going to hear me banging on this keyboard mad if I can't make these things work. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. There's a Arvin over my shoulder invites you to hamradionow.tv. There's an Arvin over David's shoulder. Let me make your Arvin big there.
There you go. There's my Arvin.
There's an Arvin on my shoulder.
You got an Arvin too. That's right. Sam's got one too.
Except that Sam is frozen. Oh, we got no picture.
Oh, Sam's frozen again.
Yeah. So just if
imagine an Arvin on my shoulder.
Yep. If you enjoy the programs and stuff, there's as I've been saying, the Ham Radio Now account is dwindling because the only thing that comes into it these days are the Patreon and the individual PayPal contributions, and while they're good, they're not enough to really keep this going. So think about it hard if you like the program. And now we'll get rid of everything from the screen. And how are we going to do this, David? Oh, you're too sleepy to think. You're too sleepy to plan.
Yeah, you know, actually, I thought about it a couple of minutes ago, and I'm thinking either I bow out or we start it together.
I think we give it to our guests to complete the sequence. So
we can do it together last.
Okay. There's three.
And
Sam,
you guys know where we're going with this.
Yep.
Yes.
Okay. Oh, so Sam, you get the first word.
Over.
Okay,
and
wait, who's doing the second word, Gary?
We're doing it last.
Yeah. They're going to do last.
You get two words because there's two of you. David, you and I do nothing.
Oh, I'm just going to be quiet. Okay, yeah. So you guys get the second and the third word.
Okay, so we've rehearsed once. We'll back to Sam. Sam, one more time.
Over.
And out.
You know how much it tickles me when we encounter people out of the blue that know how their shows end? Because nobody makes it down to this part of it. All right. Thank you, guys. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. And enjoy the eclipse.
Thanks.
You too.
Hope it goes well for you. Yeah, you guys have a great time.
Okay. We're going to hang up here. And Sam, thank you. My last minute addition. You had enough active video. And this is a pretty good still picture from you. So I'm pretty good shape.
Yeah. I'm actually just really good at staying still
for
long periods of time.
And I thought I hung up on Don and Betsy, Don and Betsy, but they seem to be still there.
We're still here. We're hard to get rid of. But Sam should save that picture. That's a fantastic still.
Yeah, I'll give you the full screen. You can do a screen capture of that. And
got it.
All right. Now, can I remember how to
profile
picture? See now. The picture from Don and Betsy went away now, but their sound is still here. I don't know how the Skype works.
Their picture is still on my screen.
Okay. David, you going to go to bed?
Yeah, I'm going to have a little nap. I think I have a Boy Scout barbecue that I got told about this morning when I got home that I'm hosting in a couple hours. So I'll probably get a little shut eye and then we'll go from there.
Be a good idea. All right. All right. Goodbye, everybody. Goodbye, Facebook. Wait, I have to go to the computer thing and get ready to hang up on Facebook.
Yeah, so, I've been running the room.
Yep. I'm going to
7-3 all. Thank you so much, everybody, for joining us.
Yep. Clicking the Facebook button. Bye, Facebook. And turning off the computer recording. Bye, computer.